Justice for George Floyd. Why did he have to die? Why did he die, George Floyd? I stand in solidarity with you and your family. And your death was unnecessary. Your death signifies what America really stands for. And your death for me is like, you know, history happening before my eyes. It's not like there have not been people dying in the hands of police and all those kind of things, but to have this length of clarity in a video, and to have those officers who perpetrated this evil not arrested, not jailed, no consequences, just because the videos went viral, and you know, they want to kind of keep him safe. Even the whole putting him in custody is just to protect him, not even that they are actually concerned about what he has done. So what happened to George Floyd is an outrage. It is indescribable, and it's enraging. And the whole world saw that video, and everybody is enraged, everybody is angry, everybody, you know, is out on the streets protesting in different capacity. Even here in Germany, people are protesting. I don't know. There's nothing to say. There is actually nothing to quantify the situation and the length of the whole time. But I wanted to talk about some things that I have taken away from this incident. Number one is the brazenness with which this killer cop was having while doing this act. Like, he didn't give a hoot, and the all the ones that stood guard, and the people are trying to say, look, he's not moving, he's not breathing, and the man is crying, I can't breathe. Like, there was nothing the man could do that they would have even listened to him. And the whole people around, everybody just kind of looked on. Like, I mean, they were shouting, of course. I would have expected some action. I don't know if I was there how I would have reacted, to be honest, but I would think that since the man is saying, I can't breathe, and whatever they were telling him, he did, he obeyed them, he was not a threat to them, why not make a move and try to stop him, at least try to get him to stand up from his neck, because the other three are still at his back doing whatever they were doing, and the man was still digging in, putting his hand in his pocket, pushing in. Like, this kind of white supremacy is the most dangerous, because they don't even see that your life is worth anything. Look at this man, George Floyd. He has a little baby. They're never going to see him again. They're going to grow up without their father. And why did George Floyd have to die? $20. They said he gave a $20 bill that was counterfeit. And obviously, apparently, he didn't know that it was counterfeit. He was thinking maybe they don't want to give them the change or something like that. And the clerk was saying they were going to call police. He could have driven off, but he just kind of waited. He wanted to prove himself. You know, they say clear conscience fears no accusation. And that was it for him. If only he knew, he would have just moved on. But he's going to be the trigger to bring out all the bottomless rage that's been in the heart of people all this time, because they've been killing and they continue to do it. I remember Eric Garner, he was selling something on the side of the street, and this policeman came and gave him a chokehold, you know, put his hand around his neck until he died. And they took it to court and nothing came out of it. And so we have seen cases that, you know, the police have just literally taken people and killed them because they can, you know. So why did they have to kill them? Because they can, first of all. And because, two, the law, the system exonerates them. The system doesn't hold them accountable for their actions. And this policeman that killed this George Floyd, he has already 10 cases against him. And they could have stopped him from working for the police. They could have taken disciplinary action. They could have charged him. They could have done so many things, because he has been involved in so many cases before. But still, they didn't prosecute him. They let him to carry on. And so he became emboldened. He was used to it. And I think that they actually went out to kill this man. Because why would you call a paramedics if he were just coming to make arrest? You know, I think this is their style of operation. When they see a black man, they ask him questions. The fact that he's even talking back is so enraging to them. Like, they feel like you have nothing to say. Just do as I say. They'll carry you, slam you on the leg, like, just treat you anyhow they want. Because, you know, that uniform empowers them, and the gun, the state gives them the backing, the judiciary exonerates them, so the people have no justice. And even if you take it to the Supreme Court, you will have no justice. They will find one reason to exonerate them. And the fact that he was able to do that and walk away from that place, in fact he was walking around looking them like, I did it, what are you going to do, what are you going to do, you know, he was just like, yeah, look, walking around, and they were talking to him, look at what you have done. He's not responding, and you killed that guy, bro. He was just doing like this. Yeah, I did it. What are you going to do about it? Yeah, that is the pertinent question. What are you going to do about it? Because they know they can do it, and they know that there's nothing you can do about it, and they know that the government is on their side. They know that the system is on their side to pick up black men and black women, terrorize them, mishandle them, just like in the foundations of their country. That's how they have been doing it from the days of slavery. That's how they will just see any black man that is going on the way. They will say you are looking suspicious. They will just pick you. They can just kill you. They will say, why are you not in the cotton field picking cotton? Saying, why are you just walking on the street like that? They will just finish you like that. This is in their history. So they continue. That is even the reason why they form police, because in those days they don't have all this big city. Everybody was working in the farm. So they just make all these laws to empower their people to keep black people under slavery. And so they still have that privilege to be going around. You remember Ahmad Aubrey, the guy that was jogging, and they said he looked suspicious, and they wanted to stop him, like questioning what is he doing. It's something like that. They feel encouraged and entitled to see a black man and want to know his business and know where he's up and about, because it's their prerogative to arrest him and to kill him if they so deem. And the courts exonerate them. We see the case of Ahmad Aubrey. That man was killed and the police came. Everything, they looked at it. The prosecutor did not take it up. They exonerated, and they went home and continue to carry on like nothing happened. The same way this Derek Chauvin, or whatever devilish name he is calling himself, he went home, him and his team, like nothing happened. If not that this video went viral, if not that that video went viral, nothing would have happened. And even at that, with all the riots, it took 4 days, 4 whole days. And they are even putting him there to protect him. Not that they are actually, you know, incriminating him. And to even let you understand what is going on, how deep this thing is, the autopsy has come out that it was not him putting his knee in his neck that killed him. That is other underlying sickness. Well, the other underlying sickness would not have killed him if you didn't show up and put your knee under his neck. You see, but you see the process of exoneration have already started. The autopsy person have already given his own report that it was not that man that killed him. It was not the action of putting it was not asphyllation. Asphyllation meaning that, you know, he couldn't breathe. The knee in the neck prevented him from breathing. So it's something else. You know, you see how this is going. So this is showing us how endemic this mistreatment and this injustice in the system of these people. Like, it is in their bloodstream, and it's also within their government system, that they don't have any accountability as long as it is a black person. It's like your life has they don't even think that the air you are breathing is worthy. Like, it is only them that they should exist. These terrorists, these extremists, these supremacists, they think that it is only them that is worthy of life. Any other form of life is not as supposed to exist. And you see how they have carried on in this case. First, they refused to arrest him. If it was any other person, let's assume it was a black person that did this thing, he will be cooling in jail that day. He's not going to get to go home. He's not going to go home. He's going to go from that place to jail. But this one, they just left him. And I think this is how they have been operating, this team of cops that are working like this. I'm sure he has been doing it. It's just that this was caught on camera. And for you to see the brazen and the boldness of it in broad daylight, and people are videoing you, and you know people are videoing you, but you couldn't care less, because you know the system, the systemic racism and corruption will protect you. Check it out. So what moral ground do they have now to come and say maybe any other country is not doing well, that they are good, when people are under your roof and they are suffering this level of suffering and nobody can do anything about it? And even the president is issuing statements and saying that those talks, they are even saying they are going to bring the National Guard to start to kill the people to clean the swamp. So they don't even see the anger. Like, it is not worthy of anything, that they are not supposed to even be angry, that who are they should just march peacefully and go home so that everything will continue. I think that the rage is purely justified. If you cannot keep your own side of the bargain, you say that if somebody do something that they are going to, you know, face the consequences, and you continue to exonerate people who have killed other people because you don't want to hold them accountable. So why will these people not keep to your rules and do your normal thing? Like, the rage is from the bottom of the heart, and this rage has gone worldwide. Solidarity for George Floyd, justice for George Floyd, this is the chorus all over the place. Say his name, George Floyd, George Floyd. You see, now he has become the trigger to bring out all the embedded rage. What are they going to do about it? Where are they going to go from now? So this thing has taught me so many things. One, I've seen that they do it because they can. They have all the things on their side. They do it because they know that you, as a black person, you don't have anything. You are not organized. You are still going to call them the next day. They do it because they know that nobody will speak up for you. I would think that going forward, we need to address this fear that we have, this fear, this cowardice, because everybody was there. Like, how many people were there? They were just four people, and they were doing something wrong. And you know what they are doing is not right, and you know what they are doing is not constitutional. But the fear in those people around that place prevented them to try. So even if it's a stone that you throw, even how many people are they going to shoot? But, you know, that fear kind of inhibits everybody. Everybody stands back and allow them to carry on for that long. And number two, we see that every encounter with this Caucasian policeman always results in something very fatal or very, very drastic on the side of the Africans. Why do you still have to call the police? Why are African Americans not en masse in the police force? Are they prevented from being there? I don't know. I don't really understand that part. Because I would think that where they are in large population, like in these kind of cities, in these kind of areas, there should be black police people. There should not be two Caucasians running around with gun and uniform in your community. At least let them work as a team, like a man and a woman, like a black man and a white man. At least let them work as a team to minimize all this effect. And you cannot just sit back and allow other people to police your community. On top of that, you'll be calling police for each other. You'll be calling police up and down in your own community. You know that they are not going to be in your favor. You are still calling them. So you have to find a way to police yourself. You have to set up some kind of, means or mechanism to police yourself. You don't have to be involving them. In this setup that you are going to be doing, has to be respected by everybody within the community. Who doesn't want to obey should go. You understand? You really have to do something different. I know it's difficult, but after all this rage, after all this riot, are you going to go back to the, normal muster again and say, okay, let's continue like nothing happened? Because this thing is century old, it's not going away. So you have to change tactics. You know, there's something that we say in Igbo land, that Alawa Maala Rube, Ana Alakwa. Like, you are going home, you are on your way, you have not gotten home. You continue going. No matter the detraction, you have to continue. You have come this far, you have to continue. You have to continue. Where do you want to go from here? This man knows he can do this thing and get away from it. What are you going to do about it? You know, if you cry for justice, the system shows that there is no justice for you. There is no justice. The justice is there to protect their people, to protect their businesses, to protect their infrastructure. So if you riot too much, they will send the army on you. They call it swamp. They will come and clean you up. You see? So there's a lot of solidarity protests around the world, and some cops have come out to say what happened is wrong, it shouldn't happen, which means this man was really, really in the wrong, and there was nothing that's supposed to stop him from being arrested immediately. But because he's being protected, that's why they didn't arrest him immediately. Instead, they went to his house to be protecting him. You understand? So why do you allow people who have this kind of psychopathic mindset to be in uniform carrying gun in the name of the state if something is not wrong with the system? All I can say is now President Trump has promised justice. He must deliver justice in this case. He has to, because the whole world has seen these clips and the whole world knows what happened. And if they don't address this issue, they will have no moral ground to be running around the whole world, to police the whole world, to dictate the moral code, because they have not cleaned their own backyard. And if they are truly serious, they will weed out all the supremacists in their law enforcement agencies, because they know them. They know them. They are all there. They know who is who. So yeah, I stand in solidarity with you guys, my brothers and my sisters in America. I stand in solidarity with the family of George Floyd. I stand in solidarity with all the other people who have been killed in this manner, in this way, who have not had any justice. I pray that the justice that you will seek will come to you in one way or the other. And I hope that going forward, you will come out of all this more organized, more strong, and more safe. Yeah, so thank you so much for joining me and listening to me. Please subscribe to my channel, join me here, and I'll see you very soon in another video. Bye for now. Bye.